expects us to do.
These days we often get afraid of what technology is going to do to our lives. In the 70s and 80s, robots are taking over whole factories, leaving people without manpower. These days, people worry about what artificial intelligence is going to do to our cognitive lives. Will it leave us with anything as humans? But the good thing is that artificial intelligence actually pushes us to think much harder about what it means to be human. When you think about this, it's our capacity to take perspective. What with people who think differently than us? Or what with people who are differently than us? It's our capacity to imagine. Our capacity to create, our capacity to manage tensions and dilemmas. And if you think how the world has changed in the year 2006, you know, that was the year that you started this work. We lived in a very, very different environment. In fact, one way how we can remember this date is that it was the year before the iPhone was invented. Twitter was still a sound in those days. The Amazon is still a river. Many of the things that we take for granted today did not exist in the year 2006. And you started your work on social media, right? But then when you measure the capacity of students to think like a scientist, which is what we're trying to do in our appeal studies, you could actually see there has not been much change in our schooling. And the world didn't stop in the year 2009. You know, you could see that maps became dynamic, cars became electric, now they're driving without a driver. Huge changes in the way in which we think and work. But the capacity of schooling will respond to that. As many more or less static. And just think about the last 3 years. You know, if you think about, you know, the impact of cloud computing, robotics, biogenetics, huge changes in the world of technology and science around us. And yes, students learn more things. We succeed every day to teach them something more. But their deep capacity to think like scientists has more or less remained unchanged. And you can basically see some countries, you know, have been moving faster. You can see, for example, Portugal has been able to reform its education systems more effectively than other countries. So you can see basically countries like Singapore and Asia, they advance their education system. And in fact, you know, if you think you are the first one who put social emotional learning at the heart of education, in fact, Singapore did this in 2009. The entire curriculum was remodeled, reframed about what they call character, human qualities. And when they talk about sports, they don't talk about athletics. They talk about, you know, how can we help children to develop responsibility for themselves? They want to take responsibility for others. Learn things like this, courage. And when they teach mathematics, they don't think about formulas and equations, but they want to encourage and enable young people to think like a mathematician, to think creatively, using the language of mathematics. But generally, I think what we have to say is that the gap between what the world requires from people today and what our schools do is not becoming smaller, it's actually becoming wider every day. And that's why I'm so encouraged to see here in Cantabria how schools actually have become part of this. It's today's schools, not tomorrow's schools. Actually, today's schools that take these kinds of initiatives. I think that's really, really important. I want to just reflect a little bit more on what technology is going to do to our way of living, our way of working. On the one hand, you can say that technology has been incredibly democratic. Everybody can collaborate, everybody can contribute to society. But it's also concentrating power at a rate that we have never seen before, often leaving humans out of the equation. We become the slaves of some algorithms that tell us how to think, how to work. Technology has been incredibly particularizing. The smallest voice can be heard anywhere. You post something on Twitter and everybody in the world can hear that. But it's also been incredibly homogenized. Squashing individuality, squashing courage, individual thinking. Technology has been incredibly empowering. These days, to do something great, you no longer need a lot of money or a big infrastructure. All you need is a great idea. The biggest companies in the world in the last decade had a product before they had the money. You created on an image, on an idea. But technology can also be extremely disempowering. Again, when algorithms tell us how to think, how to work, or to follow, and when you sit in your car and you follow the dictates of your GPS rather than thinking for yourself about space and orientation, that's what happens as well. And where we end up on this chart has a lot to do with our human qualities. You can see that technology basically squishes out tasks that are requiring routine cognitive skills, the kind of things that are easy to teach, easy to test, and also become easy to digitize automatically. Tasks requiring technology are more important in our workplace. You put those things together, you can see really how the world of work is changing around. That's the world which young people will see when they grow older. And again, you know, you can see the task category with the steepest decline in the demand is not mental skills, it's routine cognitive skills. What we all know how to do best in today's schooling is what we are losing fastest. What we are seeing as a rise in categories is basically, you know, creative skills. We call them non-routine skills, but that's basically a way to imagine new things and social skills. Our capacity to collaborate, connect with people, to work with people who are different from us. Those are the kinds of things that are really becoming different. Technology, you know, used to be, by the time you know you started to work on social emotional skills, used to be somewhere in our smartphone. We could sort of tip it in our hand or in our computer and so on. Then it got out into the real world, basically the virtual world and the real world got connected. And today, everybody is connected. People, cities, countries, continents. But at the same time, we also live in this kind of post-truth world. In this world, it's much harder to detect what's right and what's wrong. If you think about